David Dobson, and I'll introduce him briefly. David Dobson is a student of Villa Balabash. He made his PhD in 1995. Since 1998, he works at the Mississippi State University. Last from the 10 years, he also has a position in Primorska University in Slovenia. And Mr. Dobson is a well-known expert in the algebraic theory and computation groups. And today, he started many course about a particular research where he has a lot of research done, and this is a Kelly isomorphism problem, or isomorphism problem for Kelly graphs. So I'm sure that you will learn a lot of new and interesting stuff from these lectures.
Thank you, Mr. I'd like to thank the organizers for letting me come here and talk to you. I chose this particular problem because it's one of my favorites. I was a little worried at the start that perhaps it was a little too specialized, but it was very nice for me to be able to sort of step back from the nitty-gritty details of the problem and think about the big picture of the problem. And hopefully you will see that this is in fact not a narrow problem at all, but perhaps an area all of its own. Normally, I would sit and talk to you about what a great problem it was in a little bit more detail and give you details about why I like it, but it has a lot of specialized definitions that go with it. Most of them are actually pretty easy, and there's also a lot of just basic facts that I need to know before I can sort of tell you about the problem in detail. So that part I will postpone until we have enough definitions. One other thing, as we go through this, I've sort of designed the course so that the last bit is more expository, and quite frankly, you might not even need me to be around to read it. So in particular, if you have any questions, feel free to ask, and if we have to chop some at the end, well, it really is designed so that you can read it yourself. So please feel free. You can see what a formal guy I am, please don't be shy. All right, let's start just with basic definitions, these basic facts that we need. So to start with, just let G be a group. Let S be a subset of G, not a subgroup of G. We're going to find the Cayley digraph of G. I'll call it, see if I can get the pointer to work. Just Cayley GS. To be the digraph, its vertex set is just going to be the group itself. And the edge set is going to look like this. GGS. So notice that S here is chosen from S. G is chosen from G. Now, I'm a little schizophrenic about digraphs and graphs. And you can see that, what, I used ordered pairs there, so I'm thinking of those as arcs, but I call it the edge set. And I'm going to be confused like that throughout. If I use the word graph, though, I typically actually do mean graphs. Sometimes there's a difference between digraphs and graphs, but most of the time I'm going to be talking about digraphs, unless I'm not. All right, so there's the definition. S here is called the connection set. Hopefully we'll see that. Here's an example. This is the Cayley graph on G10. The connection set S is 1, 3, 7, 9. So if you're looking up here at the edges, notice there's an edge between 0 and 3. So your little g here is going to be 0. Your little s is going to be 3. There's an edge between, say, 2 and 9. And, well, that's got the...
So is there a question?
Yes.
Excuse me. Is there any request about S should be a set of generators or
no? Just
a subset. Many people historically have defined calligraphs to where the set S is a set of generators, but I'm perfectly happy having a disconnected calligraph. S is just, you can choose it to be the whole group and have loops if you like. Now, there are conditions on S which
no
will.
Set of generators.
No set of generators. If you want to have a graph, there are things that you need to, conditions you need to impose on S, and that's one of the things that we will see shortly. All right. Right. So you get the edges just by picking a G, multiplying by S. And notice I said multiply. I'm also going to be a little schizophrenic in that typically the groups that we're going to look at are going to be abelian groups. But I need to define things for all groups. So in the definitions, I'm going to use multiplication. But when I actually do a lot of the arithmetic, it's going to be addition, of course. All right. One other thing you should notice is, what are the neighbors of 0? They are 1, 3, 7, and 9. Exactly the connection set. And that's exactly what you should think of the connection set as being, is just the neighbors of 0. Now, if you just eyeball this graph, you can sort of see that if you rotate, there's 10 vertices, 360 degrees divided by 10 is 36 degrees. Rotate 36 degrees, the graph stays the same. If you want to think about this in terms of Z10, this is just adding 1 modulo 10, and it will leave this graph invariant. So you can map 0 to 1, to 2, to 3, to any of the other vertices, and we'll prove that this is a property that all calligraphs have shortly. All right.
It should be a directed graph. But for example, from 0 to 1 there is an edge, and then also from 1 to 0 there is another.
Right, and two so edges. If I have two edges going in the same direction, I'll just identify them and call them an edge. So this is why my comment about how I'm schizophrenic about digraphs and graphs and all these little conventions that some people adopt, I will basically adopt. So if you're thinking along, have questions along those lines, hopefully I'm doing the obvious thing. Hopefully. All right. The next little thing we want to see is if you have an arc or a directed edge in a calligraph, well, this happens if and only if, just by definition, x, y is equal to g, g, s for some g and g and s. And if you'll notice, that happens if and only if you multiply the g, s on the left by g inverse, that's an s, or if and only if f, x inverse y is in s. This is often taken as an alternative definition of the calligraph. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to think of these arcs as being in the form GGS, but I'm also going to think of them as XY, and they satisfy XY, X inverse Y. So in particular, if you're thinking of our example, typically the way I would actually think of it, I'd say, okay, there's an edge between 9 and 6, 9 minus 6, is somewhat shockingly 3, 6 minus 9 is 7. So just look at the difference in the labels on the vertices. Those have to be in S. And of course, it's directed. The order in which you do the subtraction will matter. If not, then the order in which you do the subtraction is not. Okay. All right. Oftentimes, what I've been talking about digraphs, graphs, if you want to insist that your Cayley digraph is a graph, there's some things that has to happen. The first condition is that S inverse has to be the same as S. And why is this? Well, if you insist GGS, GSG is an edge, that means that, well, when you do the inverse thing, G inverse GS, and then GS inverse G are an S. And this happens if and only if S, S inverse G is an S, if and only if S, S inverse is an S. So if you want a graph as opposed to a directed graph, you need S inverse to be S, or for abelian groups, you need minus S to be S. If you want to avoid loops,
you need to make sure that the identity is not in your connection set.
In some sense, a lot of people like to insist that there are no loops, but for our purposes here, loops are completely irrelevant. The problem is exactly the same if loops are there or loops are not there. So if you want to exclude them, go ahead. Not going to matter at all. The most popular kind of Cayley graphs are circular graphs. These are Cayley graphs or Cayley digraphs of the cyclic groups of Z mod n. I guess one thing I didn't say, and I have written in the notes, for me, everything is going to be finite. You can play this game with infinite graphs if you like, and infinite groups, but I don't, and I won't today. All right, so what's the conjecture that got all of this going, sort of? And I'll come back to the sort of later. This was 1967 by Dan. He conjectured that two circular graphs with connection sets S and T are isomorphic if and only if, when you multiply S by some M, you get T. And the M has to be from Z mod n star. So it has to be a unit, and so multiplication induces an automorphism. Okay, so we conjectured that isomorphism testing for circulants was about as easy as it can get. You don't even have to check edges. You just look at the connection set. Life is great, if the conjecture is true, which it's not. This integer M is called a multiplier. So one thing people will say is that two circular graphs are isomorphic by a multiplier. Yeah, great. I'll talk more about this later. But I first encountered this problem in 1989, I think. I had no idea why anybody would ever have thought of this. There are two reasons that I now have for why people, why anybody would have made this conjecture. One of the reasons is actually mathematical and good. The other reason, which I think is probably far more likely, is because of a problem in Oyston Ore's book from 1962 on, I think it was called Theory of Graphs. This was the first graph theory book written in English. And here is the very first homework problem. You're supposed to show that the Cayley graph Z7 on Z7 with connection set 1, 2, 5, 6, and the Cayley graph on Z7 with 1, 3, 4, 6 is the connection set are isomorphic. And if you look at 3 times 1, 2, 5, 6, of course, 3 times 1 is 3, which is right there. 3 times 2 is 6. 3 times 5 is 1. And 3 times 6 is 4. So the very first problem that in English that people would have looked at was basically to verify the multiplier equivalence of these two graphs. The interesting thing, and this is more trivia as opposed to a really interesting mathematical fact, is that if you want to show these two things, or these two graphs are isomorphic, this is basically all you can do. All the other isomorphisms are related to this one in a very natural way. And we'll see that, although it's not very important. All right, the second reason, and this is the mathematical reason that you can give to see why someone might conjecture this. So I'm going to let G be a group. I'm going to let alpha be an automorphism of the group. And S, connection set. Then the group, the graph alpha Cayley GS, this is a Cayley digraph of G, and it has connection set alpha of S. So what this says is that the image of a Cayley graph under a group automorphism is another Cayley graph. So if you're trying to check Cayley graph isomorphisms, you've got to check the group automorphisms, because they're always, well, if you think about them, they will either be in the automorphism group, or they will not be. And if they're not, well, you're going to get a different Cayley graph. So let's prove this, because it's not hard. Oh, one thing I should say about the proofs, probably all day today, is that y'all have studied group theory, right? And you know that sometimes with group theory things, there are these very, very deep reasons why things are true.
And then other times you just have to do the right computation and everything is done. The proofs today are going to be, let's do the right computation and it will be done.
Okay, so let's do the proof. So first off, does everybody know what an isomorphism of graphs is? It's a bijection from the vertex set to the vertex set. It preserves edges or arcs, whatever you want to call them. So if you have a group automorphism, that of course is going to be a bijection, and its image is going to be G. So if you're looking at trying to show that these two graphs, KGS and alpha KGS, they do have the same vertex set. So that's sort of. So let's take an arc. Let's look at its image under alpha. What do we get? Well, we apply alpha to head and tails of the arc, so to speak. And now the magic happens in this second coordinate. Alpha is a group automorphism. So we pretend it's a group automorphism. We do the obvious thing. And now we're just going to rewrite this as G prime, S prime. And here, G prime is just going to be alpha of G, and S prime is going to be alpha of S. And so it has the correct form. So it maps arcs to arcs. It's an isomorphism. And again, let me emphasize, what this means is that if you want to check isomorphisms of Cayley digraphs, you have to check the group automorphisms. Now, if you're thinking about Z mod N, what, multiplying by M, that's what the group automorphisms of Z mod N are. So one way of thinking about this is that Adam is conjecturing the two circular graphs are isomorphic if and only if they're isomorphic by a group automorphism of Z mod N. So they're isomorphic by some automorphism of Z mod N. Now, in some sense, this is not terribly important, but in another sense, it's horribly important because Adam's original conjecture was for circulants. If you want to talk about other Cayley graphs, this is the nice form that's easy to generalize. So here's our problem. We want to determine the groups G for which two isomorphic Cayley digraphs of G are isomorphic by a group automorphism of G. So if they're isomorphic, they're isomorphic by a group automorphism. Okay? I told you there was going to be lots of terminology. That starts now. Let me tell you the nice thing, I think I'm going to give you like four or five definitions. The nice thing about them is that they're sort of all the same, even though they're all different. They're all going to have CI in them, or at least a lot of them do. And CI stands for, I think people argue, if it's Cayley isomorphism or Cayley invariant, whatever. But all it means is that the group you're looking at always has this property, that any two Cayley graphs are isomorphic, if and only if they're isomorphic by a group automorphism. Such a group I'll call a CI group with respect to graphs. And I put the die there in parenthesis because the problem actually is slightly different for graphs and digraphs. Okay. Now, you can talk about this property for every graph, but what if you just grab one? You can ask, well, does it have the property that any graph isomorphic to it is isomorphic by a group automorphism? Such a creature will be called a CI digraph of G. Okay, so you see the CI, it just means that isomorphism testing can be done by the group automorphisms, and then the part that comes after the dash will tell you what kind of thing you're talking about. It's a digraph or a graph or a group. And so the obvious comment, G's a CI group with respect to digraphs, if and only if every Cayley digraph of G is a CI digraph. Yeah. All right. Okay. The title of the conference has symmetry in it, so let's talk about symmetries. I'm going to bore you probably with the basic definitions, but we'll say that a subgroup of the symmetric group on the N letters. And typically, for me, I like my N letters to be 0 through N minus 1 to be Z mod N, not 1 through N, because typically I'm going to be working on
Z-mod n.
So it's going to be transitive if whenever you take two elements of Z-mod n, you can find some h which maps x to y. Okay. A few other things that I need to define along the way. The stabilizer of a point. I guess this is also called the isotropy substitute or something like that. I'm going to denote it by stabs of h and x. A lot of people will just take h with a subscript x. I'm using the stab notation just because it's more, it's got stab in it. So it will hopefully make you think of stabilizer. It's just all the things that stabilize x. I mean map x to itself. So there's just another way of saying that. It's just all the elements of h which map x to itself. And we're going to say that h is regular if the stabilizer is trivial. Only the identity fits as well. All right. What's going on with this one? Yeah, vertex transitive. Sorry, I forgot what I was doing. The automorphism group. That sentence is in here just to let you know I'm going to call it alt gamma with parenthesis around if gamma is a digraph. And of course, an automorphism is just an isomorphism of the graph itself. And it's going to be vertex transitive if the automorphism group is transitive on the vertex set. So the Cayley graph that we saw at the very beginning, where we could map 0 to any other point that we liked just by this rotation, it's a vertex transitive graph. All Cayley graphs are vertex transitive, and that's what we want to see next. So our goal now is to show you that Cayley graphs are vertex transitive. So I need to give you a group of permutations. The way I'm going to do it, let's just take G as a group, little g is in capital G. I'm going to define GL from G to G by GL of X equals GX. So all I'm doing here is taking X and multiplying it on the left by G. If you wanted to do things on the right, you can do things on the right. I like to do things on the left. That's just, I'm a left guy. Also notice that, this is written multiplicatively. If you had an abelian group, it would be X plus the group element. Okay? Just like we had X plus 1 at the very beginning. Well, let's look at this function. So first off, if GX, GL of X equals GL of Y, then I'll multiply X on the left by G, Y on the left by G. We're in the groups of cancellation, so X equals Y. This is a one-to-one function. Onto the usual cheating magic where we do the computation first and then just plug it in. If you look at GL of G inverse H, that gives you H. So it's onto, we have a nice bijection. Let's check that there are automorphisms of a Cayley graph. Well, if you take something that looks like an edge in a Cayley graph, if you multiply on the left by G, you get something that's an edge in a Cayley graph. It's just the element on the left. It's not G now, it's GH. And so all of these little G's are, all these little GLs are automorphisms of a Cayley graph, a Cayley digraph. And so since I was calling little G's little GL, I'm going to call big GL, big GL. So GL is all G sub little L's. This is the left regular representation of G. Hopefully that is obvious. Representation hopefully is obvious because this is going to be isomorphic to G. And we'll see that where the regular comes from. But once you have GL, we know that little GL is always an automorphism. So capital GL is a subgroup of the automorphism group of every Cayley. All right. This is sort of the same kind of computation. GL is transitive because if you take G and H and G and you look at H, G inverse little L, that will map G to H. Did I do that wrong? No, that's right. Right? It's H, G inverse G when you multiply on the left by H, G inverse. So GL is transitive, so Cayley graphs and Cayley digraphs are always vertex transitive. And finally, where the regular part comes from, if GL of x is a fixed point, then we'll have the gx equals x and g equals 1.
So the only thing that stabilizes a point is the identity. All right,
so GL is regular. The reason we're talking about GL is this is a very important subgroup that we're going to continuously play with. But even more is true is that this GL characterizes Cayley graphs and Cayley digraphs. This is a result of Sadducees from, I think, back in the 50s or the 60s. A digraph is isomorphic to a Cayley digraph of G if and only if its automorphism contains a regular subgroup isomorphic to G. So basically, it's got a copy of GL containing its automorphism group. Maybe it's disguised in some way. I'm not going to prove this for you, but I'll sort of give you an indication how to do it. What do? You pick a vertex. You call it the identity. If you have a regular subgroup, that means for every other vertex in your graph, there exists a unique element of the group, G sub V, with G sub V of 1 equals V. Call the vertex V, G sub V, and this is going to be the left regular representation. Okay, so this isn't a hard result, but it's not really completely germane to the topic today, except for this next little part. All right. I said at the very beginning that this problem sort of started with Adam's conjecture in 1967. Except it started in the late 20s or the early 30s, but not with graphs and digraphs, but with designs. In other words, I've been playing with graphs and digraphs. Can I switch combinatorial objects if I want? The answer is yes. And have people done this? The answer is also yes. So what we'd like to talk about now is what is a combinatorial object, and then frame the same question for these different objects. There are many different definitions of combinatorial objects. I just picked one, I picked it because it was the first one I ever saw. So I'm not like doing anything sophisticated here. So for set V, we're going to define 2 to the V to be the set of all subsets of V. So a combinatorial object, this is just an ordered pair of VE, where V is a set, and E, the edges, these are containing the subsets, union of the subsets of the subsets, union of the subsets of the subsets of the subsets. Just go on. What's an isomorphism? It's exactly what you think it is. It is a bijection from the vertex set to the vertex set that maps the edge set to the edge set. What's an automorphism? It's an isomorphism of a combinatorial object with itself. So graphs, digraphs, designs, codes, matroids, all sorts of other things are combinatorial objects. And the reason we need to see Sadducees' theorem is because this gives us a nice way of defining a Cayley object without resorting to edges. So a Cayley object X of G in some class of combinatorial objects, it's just a combinatorial object whose vertex set is G, and the left regular representation is contained in the automorphism. And Sadducees' theorem tells us that this definition is consistent with the edge definition that we saw before. All right. So more definitions with CI. The big difference here is that instead of graphs, digraphs, I'm going to put object and class. The same thing holds. If it's CI, that means your objects are isomorphic if and only if they're isomorphic by a group automorphism. If that happens for all objects in your class, it's a CI group with respect to the class. We could talk about a CI object. Is it okay if I go through these sort of fast? The CI, you should always just think, okay, I can test isomorphism for whatever comes after the dash by group automorphisms. CI object, and of course, G is a CI with respect to a class. If every Cayley object of G in the class is a CI object. So here's our problem. So just pick yourself a class of combinatory logics. We want to find all CI members with respect to that class of combinatorial object. Now, I mentioned that people in design started looking at this problem in the late 20s and early 30s, and they did get some partial solutions to the problem, but they ran into a really big problem really, really quickly in that graphs and digraphs are where you want to start this problem. The problem's a lot nicer for graphs than digraphs. It's nasty for designs. And so they were able to do sort of the first step, and then they thought about the second step, and it's bad almost immediately. We will not formally see that. There will come a point in time when I will point out and say, this doesn't hold for designs, and the proof that we'll be looking at will fall apart. All right, another problem. Well, what if your group isn't a CI group? There are people who work on the CI problem who are only interested in CI groups. So if they find a group G, if they find a counterexample, not isomorphic by group automorphism, they go, ooh, and they're done. And away they go. I am interested in the isomorphism problem. So for me, I would like a, if it's not a CI group, I still want a solution. And what kind of solution do I want? I want an explicit list, L, of isomorphisms, and I can test isomorphism solely by looking at the permutations on this list. So if it's a CI group, that means that this list simply consists of group automorphisms. Oh, I guess I did a reality check here. We're looking at Cayley graphs. They have a regular subgroup in the automorphism group. What do you do if you don't have a regular subgroup and you want to test isomorphism? The answer is basically the same. Okay, we can even get more general. What if you are looking at an object that, say, has a large automorphism group but isn't actually transitive? The objects that come to my mind when I think about such things that people who are interested in symmetry would be interested in, that don't necessarily have transitive automorphism groups, but yet we still play with them, would be the generalized Petersen graphs. A lot of them are not transitive, but they've got a lot of symmetry. And you might say, well, are people interested in isomorphisms between them? The answer is yes. So I'm going to include this in the overall scheme. Now, this is the point where we've got all of the terminology, and I can sort of tell you why I like this problem, what I should have done at the beginning. So I mentioned earlier that I first ran this problem in 1989. It might have been 1990. I have a terrible memory. My memory is so bad that my mother calls me just to make sure that I don't forget who she is. She tells me that. But I actually remember the first time I ran into this problem because I was at the University of North Texas. I did a bachelor's degree there and a master's. And I did a master's thesis. And I did it under the direction of a man named Neil Brand. Back then, he was fairly well known, but shortly after this, he became department head. And that sort of killed his career as a mathematician. You know, he moved to the dark side. I said, I'd like to do a master's thesis. He said, what do you want to do it on? I said, I don't know. So he gave me a list of five problems. I don't remember any of the other four, but this was the only one that hadn't yet been completely sorted out. So that's where I started. My approach to the problem is very much influenced by him. He was not interested in just which groups are CI groups. He was interested in isomorphisms between, let's solve the isomorphism problem. If we're lucky and life is nice, then it'll be the group automorphisms. If it's not, then what happens is your hands get dirtier and you
still want to solve the problem.
He was also not interested just in graphs, but in other combinatorial objects. So for me, from the beginning, this has not been a problem about Cayley graphs and digraphs, but any old combinatorial object. And the definition of a combinatorial object, I told you, was the first one I saw. I think it's the one that he made up, or he first found. This means that, as a consequence, I am very group theoretic oriented in my approach to this. And this is sort of an important point, because there's a completely different approach to solving these problems. It's actually extremely powerful, extremely useful. The best results that I'm going to tell you about for graphs and digraphs, in fact, were proven using this other technique. It's the method of Schur. Misha will be talking about the isomorphism problem on Thursday, and I think he will tell you a little bit more about the method of Schur then. So why do I like this problem? One, y'all like algebra, right? You get to use a lot of group theory. Y'all like graphs, combinatorial objects, and for me, the way the problem works is that I will start out doing some algebra. Eventually, the algebra will fail or not. If the algebra doesn't fail, then I'm done. If the algebra does fail, then I have to go to the combinatorial object. Then once I've gone to the combinatorial object, I will come back to the group theory. I just sort of bop back and forth. I get to play with all sorts of toys. So life is pretty good. All right. So there's the problem. Let's talk about how you might solve this problem. So this is going to be a general strategy to solve the isomorphism problem for digraphs with some symmetry. Now, I wrote the word digraph there, but as we go through this, you should notice how often I actually grab an edge or something like that, because in reality, I'm not going to. This strategy not only works for digraphs, it works for every class of combinatorial objects. I'm going to use the word digraph because everybody likes them. They're warm and fuzzy. All right, so let's suppose, one other thing about this. You may say, well, didn't Bye-Bye sort out the isomorphism problem? Didn't he do this for himself? Y'all heard about that, right? This strategy completely and utterly fails for general graphs and digraphs. It only works for things that have some symmetry, and the general feeling is that the results that you get are much, much better than quasi-polynomial time and polynomial time. Our hope is that where we've been able to solve the problem, usually we get linear out. So it's much, in practice, from what we've seen, it's much faster. So this work is not subsumed by the isomorphism problem. All right, so let's just take gamma and delta. These be digraphs. Not necessarily vertex transitive. And I'm going to assume that they have a common subgroup that's not the identity. Because as we'll see, if you pick the identity, then nothing ever happens. All right? Now, if you happen to have Cayley digraphs, of course, of group H, then you can just take this group that you picked to be the left radial representation. Okay. So let's suppose that these two graphs are isomorphic. We're going to pick an isomorphism from one to the other. All right. Now, G is contained in the automorphism group of both graphs. So here I'm only going to use the fact that it's contained in the automorphism group of delta. What we can see is that delta inverse G delta is in aug gamma for every G and G. Now let's see why that's true. So I've drawn a very sophisticated picture here for you. What does delta do? It takes gamma to delta. Now once I'm over in delta, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to apply little g. Where does that take me? It takes me to delta. And if delta is an isomorphism from delta to gamma, then the inverse takes you back.
And so if you apply delta inverse, you get back to gamma. And so you've always preserved edges, so you have an automorphism. So that is this delta inverse G delta. Okay? So, y'all see that? I don't want to sort of belabor the point, but this is sort of a big deal. It's a big deal. I'm conjugating, right? Don't know about conjugating. Everybody likes to conjugate. All right. Well, if you can do it for any little g, then of course, if you conjugate the capital G by delta, this is also in the automorphism.
Okay.
Now, if one knows the gamma is an isomorphism, you might say, well, the way I think about this is that my friend Pablo Spiga, he likes to talk about the enemy being giving you this arbitrary isomorphism. So the enemy has given me a gamma. It's a bad gamma. I want a good gamma. I want, actually, in the isomorphism problem, I want a group automorphism. But what if you didn't give it to me? Well, what other things can I do to try to produce other automorphisms? Well, I can apply to produce other isomorphisms. Well, what I can do is I can apply an automorphism of gamma first. And that just takes gamma to gamma. And then I can apply delta. So what I can do is for anything in the automorphism group, I can produce a new automorphism, hopefully nicer. Okay? So delta gamma from gamma to delta is another, hopefully nicer automorphism. Oh. And now I can apply my previous argument, and what this will give me is that gamma inverse delta inverse G delta gamma is contained in the automorphism. So the important thing here is that the effect on the original delta inverse G delta that you had of replacing delta with this new isomorphism that you got from your automorphism group is just to conjugate delta inverse G delta by gamma. Okay, so when we do this process of replacing the bad isomorphism with the good isomorphism, what we're doing is we're conjugating the original delta inverse G delta that we started. All right, so I'm not going to develop this theory in all of its generality, but let's consider the nicest possible case for the moment. Now, what's the nicest possible case going to be? Well, when we started this, we knew that G was there, right? And so anything else we don't know about. So the nicest possible thing would be that I never have to look at anything other than G that I knew was there. So let's suppose there exists an automorphism that I can conjugate delta inverse G delta by and get back to G. Now this gives me some useful information because delta gamma is then normalizer in the symmetric group of G. Now I picked Sn here. Typically it's actually going to be the symmetric group on G. I just need a set. And so if this happens, then calculating the normalizer of G in the symmetric group solves the isomorphism problem. So this is sort of a general method that you can use. In the case we're interested in, mostly, this is Cayley graphs. Here's a nice little lemma. The normalizer in the symmetric group of the left regular representation is equal to, I guess I should have put a clause in there. But alt G times GL. I'm going to prove this for you, but the proof is probably a little bit more than 5 minutes. So I will stop here, and next time we will continue.
I missed something.
What's that?
And is there a bit of juice?
Yes, yes. I was just causing problems by not wanting to say what my set was. Maybe I should have used V. I just meant the vertex set.
Okay.